I take refuge in the one bright mind. Take refuge in the teachings of the truth. Take refuge in the people who are practicing compassion and wisdom. Good evening, everyone. We are continuing a series of talks that I'm going to do with on koans. And we're using a case collection of koans called the Mumonkan, the Gateless Gate, classic collection of koans from the Song Dynasty in China. It's been used for 1,000 years to help people refine their understanding of practice, of the nature of mind, of their own being. So just as we all know that there are people who can do math far beyond our capacity, and just as we all know there are people who have the ability to do yoga asanas that we can't do, the same thing is true with spiritual life, that there are states of refinement and states of insight that we barely even know about, that we barely have even touched. And the koans are all different tools that generations of teachers have used to help refine people's spirituality, to help refine people's understanding, to help people begin to see the subtleties and the depth of spiritual practice. Spiritual practice is not about just calming the mind. That's an entrance gate that we all need to do, regardless of whether we're where our circumstance is. It's helpful to have a mind that's calm and present. But the depths of understanding can be subtle, can be profound, can have different flavors depending upon their use, depending upon the need. So this particular collection of koans, the Mumonkan, the Gateless Gate, is about how do we look into and see the non-dual, because all koans use the non-dual, that is, there is no other, there is only one thing, there is no separation. They all use that direct insight as the foundation. So, practice inevitably, if you continue, if you actually decide you're going to take on the spiritual path, and go through the different layers of separation, eventually we have to have the direct, vivid experience of non-separation. And that is the foundation of all the koans. So, the koans are used, in this particular way we're talking about tonight, are used both as inspiration for what's possible, and also an expression of different aspects of the truth. So tonight we're doing a koan called Tozan's 60 Blows. And Tozan is the Japanese name. This is from Mumonkan Case 15. And another name for the Chinese name for Tozan is Dongshan. And Dongshan Lianji. There are two different Dongshans, the one in our lineage, which we chant here at the monastery, Dongshan Lianjian, is not this Dongshan, it's a different one. But he lived in the 900s, 910 to 990. And this koan is not about history. Sometimes we look at the koans and we think, oh, this is a historical event. This is not about history. This is a teaching story. This is an expression that tries to help reveal a particular point of spiritual practice that we can touch. So here is the koan, Tozan 60 Blows, Tungshan's 60 Blows, Tungshan's Chinese. Tungshan came to see Yun Min, his teacher. When Tozan came to have an interview with Ummon, Ummon asked, "Where have you been recently?" "At Sato, master," Tozan replied. "Where did you stay during the last training period?" The training periods in Asia are generally 3 months long, but you go to a monastery for 3 months, intensive training, and then you have 3 months of travel and other kinds of training. So where did you spend the last training period at? He said at Hozu, Han. It's a place not too far away. And when did you leave there? On the 25th of August, Tozan answered. So a very ordinary exchange. It is something every teacher does when somebody comes in. You know, who are you? Where did you come from? What kind of history do you have? How have you studied? Sort of ordinary exchange. And those ordinary exchanges reveal a lot about somebody's state of mind. So then, after that little introduction, the teacher says, I give you 60 blows with my stick. The next day, Tozan came up again and asked the master, yesterday you gave me 60 blows with your stick. I don't know where my fault was. Ummon cried out, you rice bag, you stupid idiot, or something like that. Have you been prowling around like that from Kosei to Konan? That is, all these travels that you've been doing. You've been traveling around kind of mindlessly and stupidly. And at this, Tozan was enlightened. So that's the case. Ordinary conversation. The teacher then says, I give you, I spare you. You're not even worth giving 60 blows to. You're not even worth hitting. You're not even worth scolding. And the student then, Tozan is kind of struck deeply and stays up all night. Kind of, well, where was I wrong? Where was I wrong? What happened? Why did I do this? That's the koan. The next day he came back and did the same thing again. Here's Mumon's commentary. If Mumon, the teacher, at the time, by giving Tozan the fodder of truth, had awakened him to the vivid dynamic Zen life, Ummon's school would not have declined. In the sea of yes and no, Tozan struggled all through the night. When the day broke, he came to see the master again. Ummon helped him break through. Though Tozan was immediately enlightened, he was not bright enough. Let me ask you, should Tozan be beaten or not? If you say you ought to be beaten, trees and grasses and everything ought to be beaten. If you say you should not be beaten, then Ummon is telling a lie. If you get really clear on this point, you and Tozan will breathe together. Really clear on this point. So, this koan is not about beating. It's not about sticks. It's not about violence. It's about liberation. And we could talk about this koan in several different ways. We could talk about it in terms of the presentation. We could talk about it as a doubt sensation, the affinity between student and teacher, the ripening of somebody's mind, the fixed views of right and wrong. Lots of ways of talking about the koan. But the point of this koan and all koans is the realization of fundamental truth, is liberation. So, this is not about, you know, he did it skillfully or unskillfully. It's about how do we, you and me, touch the truths that are liberating? How do we touch the freedom that is inherent in this mind? The qualities of that truth are a free function. The qualities of that truth have to do with brightness and clarity and ease, have to do with the vivid, lively embodiment that comes into being every moment. The qualities of that truth is a dynamic expression. It's not a thing. So it's not that there is this thing called truth out there, and if I just get a hold of it and grab it and put it in my pocket, aha, I'm awake. But it really has to do with, can I touch the dynamic quality? The dynamic quality that's at the root of all things. That's what this koan is about. Now, when we talk about awakening in this kind of way, of liberation, of freedom, of ease, of brightness, of creativity, of the constant outflowing of the gift of life that is constantly being presented to us each moment, it all sounds good. But we're not awakened. So part of the process of waking up is realizing that we have some work to do. And the sign that we have some work to do is the suffering of our life, the friction, the grating. And that friction may be because we feel separate, because we feel lonely, because we feel pointless or hopeless, because of loss, because of confusion, because of doubt, because we feel unloved, because we're not liked, because we're sick, because we're depressed, because we feel like failure, disappointment. All those sensations we'd rather not experience, which we all know all too well. Those exact experiences give rise to the desire to be free. There's nothing like when you're really sick to want to say, oh, let me get better, let me get out of this. I hate this, I don't want to be sick. That very aspiration to not be sick, the very aspiration to be free from suffering, that very aspiration is a vital and necessary ingredient for liberation. Now, we all would rather do all kinds of things. You know, we're feeling bereft or lonely, or we're feeling like a failure. And in our culture, we have all these kind of these things that we get to do. You know, we go shopping, we go to the movies, or we go play video games, or we look for sex, or we gamble, or we indulge ourselves in one way or another, or we get a better house, or we get a better car, or we find the perfect vacation, or the perfect sartorial expression. And that's we're all acculturated to, whenever we feel dissatisfaction, whenever we feel suffering, whenever we feel that grating inside, we're all trained to go out there and find somebody else, either to blame, well, yeah, I feel this way because of him, she, or it, or I'll get a hold of this thing or that thing or this activity or this person to make myself feel better. But awakening, when we actually begin to walk the spiritual path, awakening means that when we feel this kind of grating friction, we turn our awareness in to see what the source of it is. We turn our awareness in to see what is the root of this dis-ease, dissatisfaction which I feel. Because if we are feeling unhappy and dissatisfied, and we say, okay, money is going to do it. If I just get enough money, then I'll be able to do all the things I want. There's still that restlessness at the root. And we all have had lots of propitious things happen in our life. And yet there still is this restless dissatisfaction that keeps coming up. And it's not a matter of, okay, if the Democrats are in power, or the Republicans are in power, or the Libertarians are in power, or the Green Party is in power, that they will solve my existential crisis. Because as we all know, we all have had many, many wonderful things. We've been on many, many great vacations. We've had good governments, and we've had crazy governments. And the dissatisfaction in our hearts is still there. What happens is the fundamental truths that are liberating often go against the grain of our particular culture. Our culture keeps saying, if I just pin it down, if I just get enough things, if I just get it fixed, if I just get my partner to shape up, if I just get my money together, if I just get my health, if I just can finally do, you know, all the yoga I want or the exercise I want, if I just get the right job, I'll be free. It doesn't work. The fundamental truth, for example, one fundamental truth is everything is impermanent. Everything is changing. Everything is morphing all the time. And so the very hope that we have of, I'll pin it all down, I'll get it under control, I'll get it right, won't work. It has to be in accord with the fundamental truth of impermanence. It has to be, the liberation has to be in accord with the fundamental truth that everything is morphing, everything is changing. My thoughts are changing, my emotions are changing, my circumstances are changing. Our government is changing, the weather is changing, our environment is changing. Everything is changing all the time. So if we actually have touched liberation, that liberation has to be in accord with the truth of the way things are. Be in accord with the truth of impermanence as an example. So part of practice is to actually come up against our fixed ideas, to come up against all the fixed concepts we have, all the expectations that we have about how we are and the way the world is and how other people should be. And we come up against our fixed ideas and we actually let them go. Or we see through them. We actually see the unreliability of our fixed views and how those fixed views are just causing us suffering, suffering, suffering. So how do we actually break through our fixed expectations? So we may have a fixed expectation of the world should be fair. Everything should be equal. Everybody should not be have good health care. Well, let's suppose everybody had good health care. We're still going to get old. We're still going to get sick. All the best health care in the world does not preempt the truth of illness. So we have to, at some point, if we're actually going to practice the spiritual path, if we're actually going to walk the spiritual path, we have to face the expectations that we have that are unrealistic. We have to face the fixed ideas that we have about how we should be and the world should be. And those fixed ideas are exactly what stands in the way of our own capacity for liberation. Those fixed ideas and fixed beliefs are exactly what keeps us from feeling, from knowing the inherent vitality and life of this life. When we are practicing in the spiritual path, and we are not just doing, we're doing Zazen, we have to calm the mind down because you can't actually see below the surface if the mind is all agitated until you're trying to see into a pot of water is boiling, boiling all the time, you can't actually see into the bottom of it. So it's important that we have practices that calm the mind down, that enable us to find a place of clarity and stability so that we can then look down into and see into the depths of things. There's a period of dissolution in spiritual practice where these ideas that we that have been running us for our whole life, these enculturated ideas, inculcated cultural mores that we have bought as the way things are, begin to dissolve, begin to melt, begin to, and we go into a period of not knowing. This is not nihilism, it's not numbness. It's not ignorance, but we begin to touch the mystery that's at the root of our lives. There is a mystery at the root of our lives, which is not a problem, although people are often scared of it, but it actually is the source of life itself. It actually is the source of meaning itself. That mystery that's at the core of your life, my life, all of our lives. And that mystery is touched through faith, through doubt, inquiry, curiosity. So, this monk goes to Tozan, or Tozan goes to Ummon. ordinary conversation, and suddenly Ummon hits him, verbally hits him, or hits him with criticism, or says you're a stupid idiot. Now, that happens to us all the time. You know, our life, it may happen in the form of this particular archetypal pattern of a teacher, but it may be because we lost a job. It may be because our partner suddenly turns on us. It may be because somebody leaves us. It may be because we become ill. It may be because that we broke a leg and we got a car wreck. That something just goes right into the fixed notions that we have about the way the world is supposed to work, and goes right into our fixed beliefs about how we are supposed to evolve. It goes right into our expectations. And that breaking gives rise to questions. What is true? What is right? What is the way of liveliness? What is peace? Who am I? In Buddhism, we talk about two different kinds of doubt. That there is the doubt that pulls you into things, and there's the doubt that pulls you away from things. So all of the great scientists had a kind of curiosity and doubt that pulled them into looking at, inquiring into, what is the nature of things? How does this work? And they looked more and more closely and deeply. And then there's the kind of doubt that says, oh boy, that's too scary for me. I don't think I can handle it. I want to run away. I want to close my mind. So for the spiritual path, it is important that when the universe hits us with the things the universe tends to hit us, that we actually have some curiosity about it. That we actually open our mind and become curious. What is it that is true? Who am I? We begin to look deeply. This doesn't automatically happen. It happens partly because of the roots of practice that we have cultivated. So if we have been practicing for, you know, 5, 10, 15, 20 years, and calming our mind, looking into the nature of reality, we've been practicing with a certain kind of faith, a certain truth, and then something comes up and hits us with a root of practice, we can turn that adverse circumstance into power. There was one of my first teachers, Philip Kaplow. He was in Japan back in the 1950s, maybe, with another person, Bernard Phillips. And in the Zendo, in the meditation hall like this, they would be doing retreat, long retreat, sesshin. And in those halls, they would use a kyosaku, or they would use a stick, an awakening stick. And they would hit people on their shoulders, you know, two ones, twice on one side, twice on the other side, four times. And Bernard Phillips apparently didn't want to be hit, and so they could actually put a little plaque over you saying, don't hit this person. If you ever do practice, we don't use the kyosaku here at all, but if you ever do in a zendo that uses the kyosaku, it can be very stimulating. It can really wake you up. It can add a kind of energy to your practice. It can drive you deeper. But we don't tend to use it because of all the cultural things in this culture. In Japan in the 50s, they used it very regularly. But Bernard Phillips apparently was sitting there and he hated the stick. He didn't want to be, he was afraid of it. He didn't want to be hit. He put a little plaque over him saying, don't hit this person. It's fine. And one day, the senior monks changed. And this new guy came in and he was walking around the meditation hall and he didn't happen to see that plaque. And so he came up to Bernard Phillips and he hit him really hard on both shoulders. And you know, it catches your attention, I guarantee you. He hit him really hard. And he was enraged.
Couldn't you see that sign? What's the matter with you? Aren't you paying attention? You know, stop being doing this. And he went into the teacher, and he was just angry and upset and full of, you know, of vehemence about this person wasn't paying attention. I didn't want to be hit. And the teacher looked at him and said, great, great, that's wonderful energy. I hope you can pearl that energy and power into your practice. That enormous power that has been released in you is not a problem. It's actually an advantage. Notice it, pay attention to it, use it. Well, the same thing happens with all of us when life hits us. If life hits us in some way, we have this big reaction to it. We get really worried, we get upset, we get concerned. That very life energy can be turned and poured into the inquiry into what is true, what is the nature of my mind. And that egg cracks. There's a power that is liberated. And so it doesn't matter whether this is a particular koan, whether it happened to a historical thing with some old teacher or not. It happens all the time with our life. We're hit. Something is released, usually fear, anxiety, or anger. And if we can actually take that with genuine curiosity and turn our attention in and say, what is the root of this? Who am I? What has been touched here? There is a liberation that is possible. We begin to function not from the outside in, but from the inside out. We can function not from trying to meet all of the social expectations and mores and things that we have been implanted with, but instead we can begin to actually touch the inherent vital nature of the gift of this life that happens at every single moment. And we begin to see the unique flavor of our life comes from the inside out, so to speak, and not from the outside in. But there is a movement that happens inside of us. There's a movement that happens in this life that is vital, alive, and genuine, and deeply satisfying. And this koan is about that cracking. This person who struggled, what's true, what's true, what's true, what's true, what's true, going inward and inward and inward, and actually touch the truth of his own nature. So each koan has a particular entrance gate like this. Each koan must be answered from the inside out, from the non-dual. Each koan invites us to look and think more deeply, to inquire, to be curious, and to live a life that is wholehearted, live a life that is of service, live a life that is expressing this unique life, rather than clamping down on who we think we are because of different social considerations. So, it's a little bit about this particular koan. And the essence of this koan is stabilize your mind, open your heart, and inquire. What is it that is most true? Who am I? And then from that root of who you are, you express life in the way that only you can express it. You express the uniqueness of your life and make that unique offering of your life to the universe. So, these can be great fun if you actually get engaged with them. So I hope that all of you will practice long enough and deeply enough to begin to work on some of these qualities.